All right, everyone, and hello, and welcome to Android Design in Action, the first episode of the year 2013. My name is Roman Nurek.
Hey, guys. Happy New Year. Adam Kosh here.
And hi, Nick Butch here. This time I'm joining you from sunny California rather than London, as it may say below.
Yeah, it says London. We didn't have time to change the name card below Nick. It does say London, but he is actually recording or broadcasting from Mountain View, California.
Yeah. We're not very good with Photoshop yet.
So today our episode is going to be a little bit of both design and development. Not too much development. You won't see any code. You'll see maybe like a few little pointers to things here and there. But it'll be mostly, you know, kind of for designers, but developers should definitely pay attention. So today's episode is titled Iterative Improvements, and what that means is we're going to take a look at a very bare-bones starting point app. And this is not a real app, this is just a hypothetical app. And we'll see how, over the course of a few kind of key steps, we can get it from a point at which it's kind of, you know, nothing to be talked about, kind of a really ugly-ish app, doesn't really, you know, create a great reading experience, to something that's a little better than that. Before we get started, do you guys have any comments on I guess, well, actually, before that, the type of app we're going to talk about is a basic like article reader, not really an RSS reader like Google Reader, but basically something that has a list of articles and the article details. Should we just get started? Do you guys have any comments you want to share before we jump in?
No, let's get straight in.
Yeah, let's go.
All right, let's do it since we have tons of slides. So let's look at the bare bones app. So this is the starting point. I'm sure many of you have seen apps kind of like this in the Play Store. You know, there are lots of issues at play here. You know, it's kind of hard to tell the different articles on the left apart. There's no action bar. This is using the pre-Android 4.0, Android 3.0 title bar. It's got the legacy menu button here. All sorts of things wrong with this. And obviously, you know, there's lots of, you know, wrong spacing, metrics. We'll talk about all the details in a bit, but this is kind of our starting point. So, like I said, we're going to jump through a couple of different steps, and along the way, we'll talk about what is involved in each step and how to actually do it. So the first step is to change to the Holo theme and add an action bar to your app. So you could see here that, you know, the Holo theme, actually the Holo theme automatically gives you an action bar by default, but you have the action bar at the top, and what that gives you is that gives you a sense of place into where you are in the app and which app you're in. So you see the little icon here, as well as some basic actions that are immediately available on screen. So things like refresh, if you want to be able to refresh the list of articles, as well as an overflow giving you access to things that usually you'd see under the legacy menu button. Awesome.
Yeah, and just from a developer standpoint, you know, it's really a matter of enabling a target SDK version for your application in your manifest of, I think, 11 or above, but obviously we recommend targeting the latest platform version where you can. So in this case, we just put down here a little note that says target SDK version of 17. And in addition, you know, there's a theme that you can set for Holo. So in this case, it's theme.holo light dark action bar. So that's the light theme down bottom with a dark action bar at the top.
And one really subtle thing to pick out here is if you take a look at the background color on here, you see it's changed from pretty much pure white to a slightly off-white, which is part of the Holo palette, really. And there's really good reasons for that we selected these kind of base colors for the base themes which you inherit from, because like white on mobile can be like a searingly bright color which you want to use quite sparingly, and it's not very great for kind of a background color. So you know, it's a subtle change, but it instantly makes the app easier to read.
For sure. And we've kept that throughout. So you'll see, you know, kind of the evolution of this design with more branding elements and things like that. And we've kept that default color. So let's move on. What's the next step? We have an action bar. We have, you know, the Holo theme. That gives you a little bit. You know, that improves the visual design a little bit. But, you know, what's the next step? So the next step is to customize the action bar and give your app a little, you know, kind of touch of branding. So you'll see here that we've chosen an orange color palette. And, you know, again, this is really up to you. If you have an existing service, an existing, you know, color scheme for your brand, you know, introduce it. This is the best place, I'd say, in your app to introduce branding is the action bar, since it's kind of, you know, a key structural element, yet at the same time, it's a key kind of area to differentiate. And then the little icon we chose here, this is actually not a standard launcher icon. This is a custom icon for the action bar. And so remember that you don't necessarily have to have your exact pixel for pixel launcher icon in the action bar. You can customize it so that it looks good in the kind of context of the action bar. And so the launcher icon for this app would probably be, you know, like an orange circle with a white Y, but we decided that this kind of inverted color scheme would look good here. And you'll also notice that we've introduced some of those same branding elements, some of those same color scheme elements throughout the content. So for example, I should preface that all the content here is meat specific. It's a bunch of bacon and chicken and steaks. This is just kind of example content. So
it's
please.
Very bacon friendly color scheme, actually.
Yeah, very, very yeah. bacon oriented yes. Reading experience.
Yes.
So I've had the breakfast yet. It's making me very hungry.
What is it, 7:30 a.m. over there, Nick?
Yeah.
So, you know, links and other things throughout are accented with this orange. So that's the next step. And then
I guess from a developer standpoint, I think actually, Nick, you had some blog posts up on the developer blog that outlined some ways to theme the action bar. But there's also a great tool called the Action Bar Style Generator. If you just Google for it, you'll find it, which sort of generates all those themes for you. So you don't have to worry about all the different types of elements and attributes that you need to style.
Thanks very much for that, Jeff.
All right, moving on. So the next step, and this is one of the key, most important steps. This is, I think, one of the key ways in which, you know, polished apps and apps with really good fit and finish differentiate from the less polished apps is the margins and the spacing, the way they treat white space. And this is kind of one of a UI designer's best tools in creating contrast and readability. Readability is the concept of not necessarily legibility of you know, paragraphs and words, but readability is the sense of, like, you know, given a block of text, how easy is it for the eye to consume that information? And adding margins and space is one of the key ways to do that. So you'll notice that, you know, from that previous screen, we've tweaked the spacing so that you can better separate the list of article or the each article in the list on the left from its background and from the other articles, as well as we've added some standard 16-dip margins throughout the content on the detail screen here.
And you'll probably hear us often mention the 48 dp rhythm from the design site. So that's really what all of this is based off.
Yeah, and we'll show some red lines at the end that show some of the spacings that we use on tablets as well. And this is, again, one of the key ways in which you differentiate phone or handset from tablet to make sure that again, that readability, that comfort in reading is still there. So let's move on. Unless, Nick, you had any...
No, it's just instantly got a bit more breathing room, I think. It's so much easier to scan now.
Yeah. The list. So the next step is another important way in which you can introduce consistency and a strong rhythm in your app is the way you treat photo thumbnails. So you'll notice that in the previous version, these photos were kind of, you know, all jaggedy or lopsided. They didn't have a strong rhythm because they had different aspect ratios. So one of the ways in which you can, alleviate this is to introduce a different type of scaling, and Adam could talk about that. But basically, you'll notice here that all the photos line up, they're full bleed edge to edge, and they introduce kind of a strong single line in your design. So it's very easy for the eye to separate the text from the image and to separate the images from each other, since there's kind of that light separator there.
Yeah, and then from the developer side, there's an attribute scale type which you can set to center crop, where the framework will actually do this for you. Of course, you know, if you're pulling down images from a server side or something like that, you could have the images come down at the right size already, but in many cases that's not possible. So this is actually a really good way to make sure that they're all lined up and of the same size. I really like this. It really brings the images out a little bit more, and as you say, the lines really make a huge difference there on the left.
Yeah, I've heard the before version where you have the kind of uneven raggedness described as like a jagged tooth pattern. It looks like you kind of have these gappy teeth, and it just doesn't, like, kind of scan very well. So it's a big improvement.
Yeah, what you want to avoid is, you know, if you look at your design or your UI from, you know, like a few feet away, you don't want to see like a New York City skyline, right? You want to see consistent grids. You want to see rectangular grids. And in some cases, you know, for really complex, interesting UIs, you probably want to, you know, go just a little deeper than that. You want to do some more interesting things. But at the very most basic level, if you're simply presenting, you know, a collection of information, you want to, you know, make sure that you're establishing a grid. And establishing, you know, single lines so that it's very easy for the eye to kind of follow the flow of information. Okay, moving on. I think the next step is one of the biggest, and this is something that we've touched on, I guess, a million times in this show. But typography. I think in a moment you'll see the difference that just a few attributes can make in the I guess the overall just visual aesthetic, but also just the ease in consuming information. So let's go to the next section on typography. So you'll notice that here, and this is more like micro typography, where we've looked at the treatment of text at the individual character level. I guess it's a combination of macro and micro. Macro being, you know, the typography that's kind of creating the general figures of text, the general blocks of text. In this case, we've looked at the micro aspect of that. So if we look in here to the detail or to the list screen, you notice that each of the articles, the title stands out a little more. It's a Roboto bold condensed, and the subtitle, the 18 minutes ago by the author, that was kind of made more muted, since that's kind of less important information. Once your eye settles on a title that you want to read about, maybe at that point you then want to read about the subtitle, or you want to find out who wrote that. And so once your eye settles on the title, then you can kind of make the small visual step to look at who wrote it and when it was published. But this kind of really cleanly separates each individual title from the subtitle as well. And then on the detail screen here, we've used a similar treatment for the title here. We've again used Roboto bold Roboto condensed bold, but then for the text itself, we've actually used a custom font. It's called Rosario, but this is generally, you know, not necessary to use a custom font. You can use one of the Roboto variants for body text, but we found that in this case, it may be possible to kind of introduce this custom font in a light way, not using it overly throughout the UI, not making every single UI element this custom font, but in this case, it may improve legibility. So any thoughts on typography, guys?
You want to talk about the line spacing as well?
Oh, sure. So another important aspect that you should look at when changing fonts, especially, is the line spacing. This is kind of, in typography terms, it's the leading. It's basically the space between each line. And this affects, again, that readability aspect. How easy is it for the eye to move from one line to the next? As you get to the end of one line, jumping over to the next one and starting that. So all these things, the spacing around the text, the line spacing between each line, that's all very important to the readability. And so here we've used, I think, a multiplier of 1.2, but generally, if you feel that your text is a little too cramped, don't underestimate the power of introducing like a 1.1 or 1.2 line spacing.
Yeah, and from the development side, there's two attributes generally that you want to look at here. It's Android font family and Android line spacing multiplier. So those sort of together allow you to achieve an effect like this.
And I should mention that for custom fonts, and again, use them very sparingly in key areas where it may improve the experience for reading large blocks of text. For custom typefaces, you may want to look at Google Web Fonts. Rosario, for example, is available from Google Web Fonts, and it hints really, really well on mobile. So that's another key important thing, is you want to make sure to not just pick a font based on what it looks like on the web. You want to actually try it out on a few devices and make sure that it looks really crisp, because some fonts, some TTF files, don't actually have really good hinting instructions. And so when they're taken down to smaller sizes, they're not going to look very good. They're just going to kind of be off and not very well aligned. So that's something that's definitely important to try, not just on the web, but on mobile as well. Shall we move on?
Oh, I was just going to say, I think the use of different font weights is a very good way for giving structure to your content. Like, I think exactly what Roman was saying about how you want to make this kind of strap in the 18 minutes ago kind of recede visually, but be like, you know, equally legible if you need it. Mm-hmm. Just by glancing at this, you know, this screenshot, if you look away and look back, you just stands out the structure of the content and what you want to read first, and it's so much easier to scan the page now.
Yeah, this concept of visual hierarchy is very important. You want to make sure to highlight, to establish a visual hierarchy in terms of what is the top level item and then what are its sub items. In this case, you know, the top level item is the title, right? The title of the article is basically, you know, the name that you would put in the tree for the article. That would be its title. So the subtitle as well as its body content is kind of a child of that. So that should kind of be lower in the visual hierarchy, so it should stand out a little less. Again, once your eye hits the title, then it could move on to the sub items in that tree. Go ahead and read details about that. All right, moving on. Mm-hmm. So alternatively, we actually created an alternative presentation. This is something that doesn't work in every case, and I think in this case actually it doesn't work super well, but alternatively you could combine photos and text, and this is something that a couple of popular apps do now. But what you could do is combine photos and text. Just make sure that, again, your text lines up. So here you'll notice that the text still lines up with, or the title still lines up with the subtitle, and it lines up with the body as well. So that's again very important to establish those clear lines for alignment.
So if you use a visual treatment behind the text here to give it some contrast, because you kind of don't control right. the image.
Yeah, so there's a little bit here in the sense of, like, we use a gradient. We've shown this in the past with, I think it was TripAdvisor's redesign. Nick, you used that effect, but we use a gradient, a light black gradient. So it fades from like about like a 30-40% opaque black to 0% opaque black, so that content along the bottom has stronger background protection. So if the image itself, let's say, you know, this image of a steak, if the whole image is actually white, then you'll still be able to read the text because of that background protection. Okay, so since we're running low on, well, I guess sort of low on time, let's kind of start flying through some of these. So we also added a view pager to make sure that you can swipe between the detail screens. This is fairly straightforward using the view pager from the support library.
It's apparent what swipe view is well documented on the design side.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you should, where possible, introduce this into your detail view so that you could very quickly swipe between items. So let's jump into tablet. This is let's take a flashback to our step zero. If you were to run that step zero like starting point on a tablet, this is what it would look like. So you'd have two separate screens that just make horrible use of space. You have all these large regions of white space here at the bottom. You also have very large line lengths, we'll talk about that, which makes reading really a pain. So as you're reading like the first line here, then it's time to go on to the next line. Your eye is trying to move to the next line, but it's very hard for it to find the next line because it's just not, like, this text has too long of a measure. So we'll talk about that, how to improve that.
And of course, the images are tiny in this particular view. So you know, on a tablet, that's not making very good use of the space.
Yeah, pretty terrible overall. If this is your tablet experience, this is pretty bad. You should fix it.
Instant uninstall.
Instant uninstall on the tablet, that's right. So let's say we were to, you know, fast forward and just use all those tricks of spacing and everything and see what that would look like on a tablet. You know, it's much better. It's still not great, right? Because you still have those long lines. You still have that image that where now the aspect ratio is completely different from the source material. So you only see the very middle strip of the image, which is fine in this
Doesn't
case.
Look too bad in this case, yeah.
Yeah, it's still a strip of bacon. You can't go wrong with that. But you could do better than this, right? So the next step is to create a two-pane UI. So in this case, what we've done here is we've simply combined the master and the detail into a single two-pane UI. And this is, you know, fairly straightforward. We have you can actually do file new in Eclipse. You can do file new master detail flow to get you the basics for this. But there's also some articles you could read.
Yeah, developers.android.com/training has two really good training classes on that.
Yeah, so it's fairly straightforward to do it these days. There's a lot of pre-written code for you. It is fairly complex code if you're just a beginner, but it's kind of like file new and you're done. And you can read about the details here in these training articles. So moving on, how would we then improve this? So what we can do is now start tweaking the margins and the spacing and the different dimensions on tablets, so that when you open up the same detail view on a tablet, you'll actually get larger text. For example, you get more spacing around the sides to again better separate the figure from the ground, better separate the text from its background. You can bump up font sizes, you can bump up line spacing again. Lots of things you can do here to make it better. And it's fairly easy from the development side as well.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully, when we're talking about the phone side, you extracted all of the different dimensions, padding, spacing, into a separate XML file. And then you can choose sort of when you want to bump those up again, at which screen size you want to bump them up. So in this example down the bottom here, it's at smallest width 600 dp and at 720 dp for 7 and 10 inch tablets respectively. But of course it's up to you when you want to tweak those sizes. This is just sort of the standard and what we would recommend for looking at different sizes.
Mm-hmm. And you can provide multiple switch points, right? So you can mm-hmm. have different metrics on a 5 inch, 7 inch devices.
Yep.
Yeah, for sure. And actually, one that we don't often talk about is small devices. So devices that have really small screens, you may want to tweak things even further there. Maybe even start compressing information into like separate navigable sections. If your user base is on small devices, then again, that's something that you want to do using something like SW300 or 200 dp or values-small, for example. All right, so let's actually look at some of the metrics here, take a quick sidebar. So you'll notice that, and again, this still uses the 48 dp rhythm in the sense that things are generally multiples of 48 or 16. And for smaller sizes, we use like 32, 16, 24, 8, things like that. Powers of 2 and things divisible by 4, roughly. So here's just some of the quick examples. Generous margins around the content here. I mean, 80 dp, if you're not using something as large as like 80 or 64 dp for margins on a tablet, then you probably should be, since you really want a lot of space so that the eye can comfortably read the content. And then the font size here is fairly large, 48 sps. Okay, let's also look at that same alternative. So again, with the photo behind the text, it's even more evident here that there's a background gradient. But again, the key point here is that you'll notice that the alignment is still there. The text still aligns so that the eye can very quickly read. We've been talking a lot about reading. If you're interested in reading more about this, look up macro typography as well as readability. There's a lot of great articles out there on how to best kind of create a very readable experience. Let's keep flying through. So some extra credit things that we did. What could a notification be like? Let's say you're a blog author or an author, and you're posting stuff to this Bacon site. Let's say that there's some sort of background process that says the photo's uploading, the text is uploading. What could a nice notification be? You could get a notification with kind of a preview of the photo that everything's been uploaded. And then when you swipe over, you'll notice, or when you swipe down, you'll notice that the expanded version actually has that photo, lets you maybe share the article. And this is all very easy to do from a developer standpoint.
Yeah, there's a class called Notification Compat, which I think we've mentioned before, that allows you to build these richer notifications from newer platform versions, but remain backward compatible with older versions.
Yeah.
Definitely good to use.
Yeah, super, super trivial, I'd say, to use. It's only like a couple lines of code. We're also working on a template. You can do file new notification. It'll just build all this code for you. So moving on, another quick tidbit is if you're using a web view for presenting content, then you're automatically going to get this. But if you're not, if you're using a text view, by default, your text will not be selectable. So if you long press on the body content, nothing will happen. So there's a really neat little trick that you could do. You can set a single attribute on your text view, and this is more for developers, of course, that makes that text selectable. And from there, you can obviously customize. You can say, allow people to share this text or copy it, and so on.
And surprise, surprise, that attribute is called
text is selectable.
Easy.
Very simple. All right. let's keep moving on. Okay, so I think this is the last step here. This is what it looks like. So you guys remember from the very beginning, you know, the very, very beginning starting point was, you know, it was just all over the place, didn't look good on a tablet, the spacing was awful, it was hard to kind of pick out the articles from each other, the photos weren't well aligned, the typography was, you know, just very bare bones. And so with just a few tweaks, and I think that actually all these screenshots are screenshots, they're not Photoshop mockups. I think overall it took us, you know, a few hours to put this all together. You know, each one of these tweaks is very incremental. It's minor iteration, right? It's not like a revolutionary design by any means. So with very little work, I'd say you can get to this point. So you should definitely get to it. All right, with that, and unless you guys have any final thoughts.
No, I think it's been really awesome to kind of show the processes and the things we think about and look at in a redesign.
Cool. So
hopefully it's been-
Yeah, it makes me want to eat some bacon ASAP.
Yeah, we're past lunch, but I think Nick is almost there. So let's let's jump into Android design news. So we don't have too much design news today. Nick, do you want to start with Gunther's blog post?
Yeah, so Gunther and the guys from Apollo did a really, really good blog post talking about the importance and the opportunity of using widgets in your with your application. And I think they really summed up the opportunity here for me. That, you know, this is a prime piece of real estate on the user's device where most of their user journeys start from, and you get to kind of show, you know, another avenue for your content and have a really quick and easy way to put stuff on their home screen. And it's kind of a shame when many apps don't offer this functionality. So really think about how widgets might work with your app and your content.
Absolutely. Next up, we have from Taylor, we have the wireframe screen flow template. I'll briefly just mention that, you know, it's very important to map out the different interactions in your app, not just the visuals. You know, so like when you touch this, what happens? When you pinch here, or double touch here, or swipe here, what happens? And so this is a great starter template for basically giving you the different gestures that you'd want to do, as well as linking up different screens using these little red arrows. So if you're starting from scratch, you may want to just start from this point if you're mapping out the interactions within your app.
It kind of helps you think about navigation as well. So mm-hmm. if you think you have like multiple routes into your content, so say we've done a widget for the bacon app we've just been looking at, you know, you might come into a detail screen. So it helps you to think about how the parent like. The hierarchy might work as well, I think.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Moving on, we have, okay, so at this point we should talk about the different communities out there. So there are two communities, and these are evidenced by our two slides here. There's the official Android design community on Google+. If you haven't joined it, you know, feel free to join. There is an issue currently with the community in the sense that there's a lot of spam and a lot of kind of off-topic posts. We're currently kind of exploring ways in which we can make the community more valuable, provide more value for everyday designers. So definitely, you know, if you have some questions or if you like, you know, want to start a discussion thread about a certain topic, feel free to post here.
But there's some subtopics in there, right, as well. So it's like right. Design feedback requests and so on, like
right.
Tools and free.
Yeah, if you have any questions about your design, if you want you know, folks in the general public to provide comments on your design, feel free to post a few screenshots. I'd avoid posting links to apps because that can be viewed as kind of spammy. But if you could post some screenshots, though, you know, folks generally are good about providing feedback.
Yeah, the most discussion seems to spawn around like a specific question, like how do you feel about my spacing on X kind of thing, rather than what do you think?
Yeah. All right, and then there's also the unofficial Android designers community, which I believe they have an approval process, but it's like fairly lightweight. So, and this is more for like professional Android designers. Like, if you're doing design work for, you know, for a company, for a client, or even for your own company that you work for, and that's your kind of core job, this is kind of like a more advanced, more kind of. I'd say maybe like higher level thinking community. There's lots of good content on here, so I advise joining both at this point. Okay, and I think lastly, Cahil, I'm gonna butcher your name. Sorry, Cahil Nettleton has posted a PSD version of all of the icons in the Action Bar icon pack. Available on developer.android.com/design/downloads. He's posted that in a PSD format. So if you don't use Illustrator or if you don't have Illustrator, and you just want the shapes in PSD format, then this may be for you. So yeah. Oh, actually, there's one more. Yes. Mikhail has done a great job in taking all of the slides from episodes 1 through 12 of the show, basically everything we did in 2012, and putting them into a single zip file. So if you've wanted that, if you don't feel like going through all the Google Plus posts and fetching all the screenshots and all that, it's available in a single zip file available on his Dropbox. If he decides to take it off of his Dropbox, then, sorry, but he's done everybody a favor in doing this, so thank you, Mikhail. All right, with that, I think that's our last slide. Any parting thoughts, guys?
One more piece of news, actually. I forgot to add it into the show, mm-hmm. but I just saw it in one of the screenshots from the communities. Mm-hmm. If you're in London, there's an event going on in the Google Campus building on the 25th and 26th of January, so next weekend. Design and developers kind of coming together and talking about designing for Android. So if you can make it to London, then check it out. And for more information, go to the London GDG, the Google Developers Group. Go to their Google Plus page and you'll find all the details.
Cool.
Great.
All right. Well, thanks for joining us in Android Design in Action. As always, I'm Roman Eric.
Adam Kosh.
And Nick Butcher.
See you guys later.
See ya.
Bye.
Peace out.
Bye.